Okay, welcome everyone. Oh, thanks so much for being here with us tonight on this very cold Wednesday evening. Welcome. Welcome everyone. We'll give everyone just a minute to get logged in. Welcome. Looks like we have just a couple more people tuning in. Wonderful. So great to see you all. Okay. Okay, let's go ahead and get started. Thank you again so much for being here, everyone. My name is Rebecca Ramsey. I'm the Executive Director at Swan Valley Connections. And Swan Valley Connections is your host this evening and every first Wednesday of the month for our educational speaker series. And Swan Valley Connections is a collaborative conservation and education organization located right in the heart of the Swan Valley, about halfway between Seeley Lake and Swan Lake and just south of Glacier National Park. And we work with private landowners to help them with their forest health and wildlife coexistence and all sorts of any sort of issues that they may have on their own property. We work with our public and private agencies for public land stewardship. We provide visitor services to the public, and we provide educational opportunities to people of all ages, just like this program tonight, as well as master naturalist programs, animal track and sign classes, and many more opportunities, including two semester-long college programs with credits through the University of Montana. We aim to connect people to the natural world in all of these ways, and our mission is to inspire conservation and expand stewardship in the Swan Valley and beyond. So thanks for being here with us. And tonight we are so excited to have Dr. Rob Thomas with University of Montana Western to talk about the geology of Montana. And so before we get started, I just wanna remind everyone that this program will also be recorded. It'll be posted to swanvalleyconnections.org and on our YouTube channel. You can find it there, usually within just a few days. You can also get on our mailing list if you'd like to learn more about our organization at that same address, www.swanvalleyconnections.org. And tonight, if you have questions throughout this program, and I'm sure we will, that it's so exciting to learn all about the last best place, you can just go ahead and type your questions into the Q&A box that is at the bottom of your screen. And at the end of the program, we will go through all of the questions that are there. So again, just type that into the Q&A box at the bottom and Rob will be able to answer all your questions at the end. So without further ado, Rob, thank you so much for being with us tonight. Go ahead and take it away.
Okay. Well, thank you so much for having me. The goal of the talk will be to cover the geological history of Montana from the oldest rocks to the youngest. I'll try to specifically target out some of the more important events that affect the Swan region, and we'll do that again in the context of the geology of the state as a whole. I recently, with Dr. Don Hyndman, professor emeritus at the University of Montana in Missoula, published Roadside Geology of Montana, the second edition. Many of you might be familiar with that book. It Let's see. Doesn't seem to want to, there we go. That book originated as this spiral bound book on the left, The Roadside Geology of the Northern Rockies by the late great Dave Ault, who is here on the right. And that book was transformed into the state geology books, including the Roadside Geology of Montana, which was the first book in the series to be published on out of this initial book. What I always like to point out is the $395 tag on the cost of that Roadside of the Northern Rockies book. The book now runs about $30, but it's still well worth it. And if you're interested, please do buy from your local bookstore if you can to support them. All right. So let's take a journey back in time and go through the geological history of the state from the bottom up. Geology is read like a book, only backwards. We read it from the oldest to the youngest, the bottom to the top. And the events that are recorded record everything that has happened essentially on the planet. We have preserved the life of the planet, the chemistry of the atmosphere, the chemistries of the ocean. Okay, you still there? Rebecca, still on?
I am not sure what just happened there. Let's see. Okay, try that again. Everything just bleeped out, but it looks like everyone's still with us.
Okay, oops. All right, not sure how to get that out of there, but I'm going to just move that screen over. Okay, so the slides okay?
Nope, now I don't have the slides.
Okay, so let's try screen share again. How's that?
It's coming on. There's just a little pause, it looks like. Okay, now you're back to where you were.
Okay, very good.
Well, nothing like a little technological difficulty.
No, that's good. And it didn't take geological time to fix it.
No. So looks like we can just see at the bottom, we can still see like your toolbar across the bottom.
Yeah, okay. I'm not sure if I can get rid of that or not. There we go. How's that?
Brilliant. You got it. Good job.
Okay. So the oldest rocks in the state are over in the Beartooth Mountains, and they are roughly, well, there are minerals that go back to 4 billion years in age. The minerals are zircons, which are very resistant to erosion and just keep getting recycled. And they are born in igneous rocks, and then they end up being deposited in sedimentary rocks and preserved. And so the oldest mineral dated in the state is a zircon crystal out of a quartz sandstone that's been metamorphosed to what we call quartzite. And it dates to 4 billion years. The planet itself is 4.5 billion years old. So that makes the rocks here in Montana almost as old as the Earth itself. The Beartooths were part of a large craton we call the North American Craton. You can see it on the lower left in the screen, that brown area. And that's an old proto-continent, piece of kind of original continental crust of the Earth. The rocks are highly metamorphosed. So the picture on the left shows a folded and banded rock called gneiss. And it is that way because it's been under lots of heat and pressure over time. I kind of like to say rocks are like people. The older they are, the more metamorphosed they are, the more changed they are. They're just a higher probability that they're going to be involved in a plate tectonic event that changes them. Along with the bare-tooth granitic gneisses, they go back 3+ to 4 billion years of age, are rocks about 2.7 billion years old called Stillwater Complex, which are south of Big Timber and near Nye, for those that know the region. And the picture on the right shows a picture of these igneous rocks. They're layered igneous rocks, and they're a major source of platinum and palladium that is mined here. In Montana, it's utilized primarily in catalytic converters. All right, by about 1.8 billion years ago, there is a collision of continents that occurs in Montana. The diagram on the left shows pink area called the Medicine Hat Block. And down to the lower right is a gray area called the Wyoming Craton. And in between the two is a purple area called the Great Falls Tectonic Zone. And that's the collisional zone between these two great blocks of continental crust of the Earth. And that collision caused more metamorphism about 1.8 billion years ago, more change through heat and pressure. It probably uplifted some pretty big mountains. These are the kinds of collisions that we see today where India is colliding with Asia. So it's uplifting mountains like the Himalaya. And so we might have had mountains at that time here in Montana that were Himalayan in size and origin. And you can see those rocks on the right-hand side. They just look tortured, beautifully so, but tortured, all folded up and layered into bands, which is a function of pressure and temperature. Okay. Then starting around 1.5 billion years ago, western part of North America started to pull apart, what we call a rifting event. There was a big supercontinent that had formed by that time that we call Nuna. And Nuna started to break apart. And as it broke apart, there were injections of ocean floor-like material because that's how oceans form. They form as continents break apart. And along some of the faults that were forming as the crust of the Earth was being pulled apart, hot water percolated along them and made the talc deposits that we have here in Southwest Montana. It opened up a big open basin that we call the Belt Sea. You can see that on the block diagram on the left. And there were highlands off to the east, and sediments were derived off of that and to the south and into the Belt Sea. And it was all being deposited at a time when the Earth was just newly starting to have free oxygen. The only life that existed that we really can be certain of was single cellular life. So no multicellular life, no animals, no true animals. And that life was all prokaryotic, essentially bacteria. And these bacteria, many of them were photosynthetic. Made mats. And the mats of bacteria that was synthesized in the shallow waters of the Belt Sea trapped sediment and created crinkly mounds, which you see in the lower picture, what's called a stromatolite. The upper picture shows ripple marks of wave oscillation across the surface of sandy mud in the Belt Sea 1.5 billion years ago. And Those are now exposed. That particular picture was taken at Logan Pass in Glacier National Park, where these rocks of the Belt Supergroup are spectacularly exposed. They make up a very large percentage of the hard rock that you see in all of Northwest Montana, including the Sealy Swan. They are just spectacularly exposed in Glacier for those that have done the transect over Logan Pass. Okay, and again, the lack of multicellular animals in this environment allowed the preservation of these beautiful sedimentary structures because there was nothing there to churn up the sediments and destroy the structures. All right, by about 800 million years ago, there's another supercontinent called Rodinia, and it breaks up again. That's what supercontinents do. They form, continents collide and they form large masses of continent. And then that creates a lot of trapped heat. And that trapped heat underneath those big continents causes them to break up. And so Rodinia broke up about 780 million years ago. And we see the evidence of that again with the injection of ocean floor igneous rock, basalt. And for those of you up in the northwest part of the state, that's the Purcell Sill, which is so prominent in the park. You can see it in the photograph in the lower left, spectacular exposure of a dark layer of rock with two light areas, one above it, one below it. And that's an injection of this basaltic rock into the sedimentary rocks of the belt. And it bleached or metamorphosed the surrounding limestone that it came into and made marble. That's what the white rock is. And again, you've seen this before if you've been in Glacier, the Purcell Sill. It's widely exposed throughout the park, through Glacier Park. All right, so by about 520 or so million years in Southwest Montana, these rocks that had previously been deposited and the mountain ranges that had been created were essentially eroded down flat. And the continent of North America and the Western US in Montana was flat. So you can think of Montana at 520 million years ago as basically flat with a few little nubbins of islands in places and maybe a few areas of some exposure of rock. There was a little active uplift going on at that time, but pretty much eroded down. Sea level rose as the supercontinent broke up and glaciation went away that had existed over that supercontinent. And as the sea level rose up, it transgressed across the continent. Whoops. And it, my pointer unfortunately doesn't work, but the picture of the student on the right, if you look right behind him, are layered rocks with a injection that's light colored through it. Those are metamorphic rocks and a igneous dike or intrusion in the basement rocks. Those rocks there have a metamorphic age on them of about 1.8 billion years. From that big sky orogeny, the collision of continents. They were eroded completely down to sea level, and the overlying rock, it has all those chunks in it that you can see well above his head that are tan in color. Those are ocean deposits. They're beach sands, and they have the remains of the fossils of trilobites and a clam-like animal called a brachiopod in them, and they were beach deposits, and they show that the ocean rose up and transgressed or flooded across the eroded old rocks and deposited beach sand. And that beach sand eventually made it all the way to Wisconsin and Minnesota and other places in the Midwest of the United States as the sea literally buried almost all of North America. So you can see that on the diagram on the right. There was a thin sliver of land that existed throughout the mid-continent of the United States, and the rest was covered in shallow water. And you can see that the equator, shown by the line with the north arrow on it, was very close to Montana. Montana was in the southern hemisphere and very, very close to the equator. So that water was tropical and warm. And it was conducive to tropical marine life at that time, including trilobites, which is the carapace that you see as a fossil in the rock on the left. That's the shell of a marine arthropod, basically a crab-like animal that was abundant at this time and left its hard shells in the rocks for us to see that they once existed in shallow tropical ocean water in Montana. All right, well, that sea level rise persisted. It went in and out and in and out and in and out, but it persisted over North America throughout this period we called the Paleozoic. So all the way essentially to about 250 million years ago. And again, starting at about 520 million years ago. And one of the most obvious deposits across Montana from this event is called the Madison Limestone. The Madison Limestone makes up Lewis's lookout at the Three Forks. It makes up the gates of the mountains outside of Helena. It makes up Beaverhead Rock near Dillon. It makes up colored cliffs south of Big Sky in the Gallatin Canyon. It is a very prominent layer. You've seen it. And when you look at it closely, it's full of the fossils that you see over there on the right. The clam-like animal on the top, that's a brachiopod. The horn-shaped fossils are corn corals are what are called rugose corals. The stalk-shaped animals look like a stem that have the star-shaped symmetry. Those are called crinoids. And so life teemed in these tropical shallow oceans that covered all of Montana during this period of time, leaving this massive limestone deposit. Again, that we call the Madison group or the Madison limestone. You also see it along the Smith for those of you that have floated the Smith. All right. As we get to the end of the Paleozoic and we go into the earliest Mesozoic, which is from 250 million years to 65 million years ago, there's another supercontinent called Pangaea, all lands. And it breaks up like supercontinents do. And you can see on the right a map showing this breakup. There's a linear sea that's separating what you can see is the outline of Western Africa on the right from North America on the left. And you can see where Montana is in that diagram through the outline. And as it opened up, it pushed North America into the Pacific Ocean floor, which is off to the right of Montana. And as the two collided with one another, the ocean floor, being heavier than the continent, started to subduct or go underneath the continent of North America. And it started to create mountains. And as those mountains rose, sediments were shed off of them. And those sediments were shed off into a big basin in Montana to the east. And living along the edges of the streams and the lakes and the swamps in that basin during Jurassic time were Jurassic Park animals, the dinosaurs. And for a long time, we really didn't have a great collection of dinosaurs from the Jurassic in Montana. But we've since found some deposits of juvenile sauropods. You know, for those that learned your paleontology from Land Before Time, that's Littlefoot. we find Littlefoot in the Jurassic Morrison Formation near Dillon. And that's a little toe bone that you can see on the lower left in the presentation. All right, as we go through the Mesozoic, the collision is in full bore between the Pacific Ocean floor shown in that diagram on the left and the continent of North America shown on the right. And it does several things. The ocean floor subducting what's called the Fairlawn plate. As it descends, it heats up. And as it heats up, it releases water. And water lowers the melting temperature of rocks in the continent that are already hot, and they melt. And that melted material rises up through the continent and finds avenues to the surface in some cases, and others not. And it crystallizes granitic rocks in the subsurface and volcanic rocks at the surface. We see those in places like the Bitterroot and from Butte to Helena, the Boulder batholith, the Pioneer Mountains near Dillon, the Pioneer batholith. We also had rocks being compressed that had been deposited prior. So the Paleozoic and some of those Mesozoic rocks get folded and they get shoved from west to east by this collision. And that's shown on that diagram, the fold and thrust belt. And there's a picture of it on the right. That's the Sun River Canyon outside of Augusta, Montana. And those are older rocks that form the cliff walls up high, Paleozoic in age. And those are younger rocks, Mesozoic shales, Cretaceous in age, below that red line in that photo. That's an older over younger relationship. That's not the way layers occur in rocks. They are from older to younger, not younger over, or not older over younger. It's younger over older. So to get the section reversed, you have to break the rocks and they have to be shoved up and over the older rocks, up and over younger rocks. And that's what's happened here at the Sun River Canyon. So next time you go there and you come into the canyon, you'll see this. You can see this from the road. It's a fault that is no longer active, called a thrust fault, that thrusted these up older rocks up and over the light colored rocks, up and over the younger rocks that are dark in the foreground. All right. And the other thing that happened is the compression between the two plates warped the crust down and created an interior seaway called the Western Seaway, or the Foreland Basin is what the geological term is for the downwarp. And so that downwarp collected sediment in it, in the Western Interior Seaway, some of it marine, some of it adjacent to the marine streams and lakes and swamps. All right. So here's the igneous rocks. These are the humbug spires on the right, big fins of granitic rock that were intruded several miles below the surface of the earth during that collision that occurred during Mesozoic time. The map on the lower middle shows the distribution of these rocks. The ones that crystallized below the surface are shown in red. The ones that crystallized at the surface as volcanic rocks are shown in orange. And this is a very important event in our history as an immigrant culture in Montana, because it created the mineral deposits that were at the heart of immigrant migration into Montana. So the gold in Butte, and the gold, silver, copper, molybdenum, I should say, in Butte. The deposits, the metal deposits in Helena and Last Chance Gulch, Bannock near Dillon. All of these are Cretaceous age deposits of metals related to the intrusions of these granitic rocks. All right, off to the east. Different things were going on at that time. We had this Western Interior Seaway, which is shown on the map, and you can see it covers central and eastern Montana. It connected up the Gulf of Mexico with the Arctic Ocean, and it had lots of dinosaurs living along its margins. It had plesiosaurs, the Loch Ness monster, swimming in its seaway, and many other swimming reptiles, and clams, and very large coiled nautiloid-like animals called ammonite. And they thrived throughout the Jurassic and the Cretaceous in particular, when the seaway was at its height in size in Montana. And again, dinosaurs were living on the margins of this. They were nesting in these marginal environments, and volcanoes were erupting off in the west, and those ash deposits would come in and bury the nesting sites. And that's why we have Egg Mountain, for example, up by Shoto, Montana. It's where there was a rookery of hadrosaurs and other dinosaurs, and their nests were buried, and it preserved not only the eggs and the adults, but juveniles as well. And that's a reconstruction of one of the juveniles that Jack Horner did at the Museum of the Rockies, on that photograph on the left. The middle photograph is from Mikoshika State Park, and the geologist, she has her hand on the boundary between the Cretaceous, the last period of the Mesozoic, and the Tertiary, the beginning of the Cenozoic, the famous dinosaur extinction layer. And so that's marked by that layer of coal that she's got her hand on in that picture. So we have the great dinosaur extinction event here in Montana. Not just there, but that's a great place to see it. If you've never been to Mikoshika State Park, you should go. Okay, so as we transition from the Mesozoic into the Cenozoic, the subducting slab of ocean floor appears to shallow up. And going from the diagram you see on the top right to the one on the lower right. And as it did, it caused blocks of basement to be raised. And you can see that in the block diagram on the left. That's a cartoon of the Beartooth uplift. It first uplifted during this time period, in the very earliest tertiary, and it raised basement up, and it draped the Paleozoic, Mesozoic rocks over it. And so if you've ever been to Beartooth Butte, that's a little remnant of those sediments sitting on top of the old Precambrian metamorphic rocks. And they're along the front of the Beartooth forming palisades or fins that stick up. And you can see that in that photo to the right, which is in the Red Lodge area. And as these mountains were uplifted, they shed sediment off to the east, creating a vast alluvial plain from streams, and those formed rivers or formed swamps as well as they entered into the Cannonball Sea in North Dakota. And these are the origins of our great coal deposits in places like Colstra, Montana. So they were formed in this very earliest tertiary time period as sediments eroded from the west, were transported towards the east and buried plant material in swamps that were in southeastern Montana primarily, and eastern Montana. All right. Well, the volcanism wasn't quite over. By earliest tertiary time, a period we call Eocene, the Eocene epoch, say roughly 50 million years ago, there was widespread volcanism throughout western Montana. We know them as the Dillon Volcanics in the Dillon area. Up by Butte, they're called the Lowland Creek Volcanics. Out on the Great Plains, up by, say, Haver and the Bear's Paw and so on, they're called the Central Montana Alkalic Province because they're made up of a strange igneous rock that includes minerals that are not commonly found together. And they formed a massive area of active volcanoes through Yellowstone National Park and up into the Gallatin range around Bozeman. Those are called the Absarca volcanics. And they're the origin of the fossil forests that you see down the Paradise Valley in the Tom Minor Basin. And of course, the fossil forests in Yellowstone National Park as well, and other places around Southwest Montana. We've got plenty of fossil trees in the Dillon area from this time period as well. Most of the trees were living on the slopes of the volcanoes and the river valleys below. And when the volcanoes would explode, they would send walls of water and muck, just like Mount St. Helens did in 1980, down the river valleys, and that's called the lahar. And those massive flows of water and mud would pick up trees and rapidly bury them, and they're full of silica, and that silica permeated into the trees and made them into stone. And so that's why you have so many fossil trees in that whole region of south central Montana and Wyoming, or if you will, southwestern Montana and Wyoming. Okay, by a period of time shortly after that and overlapping with that, everything starts to fall apart and Western Montana begins to extend. We get what we call metamorphic core complexes. Big, large, low angle faults formed that raised rocks from depth and caused the rocks above them to detach off of them as they slid off on a slippery surface, forming a rock we call mylonite, which is basically a detachment fault. And the rocks are all smeared out because they were hot and they were sliding. And so we see a texture to them that shows this sliding that occurred within the rock, and that's called mylonite. It formed the very first extensional basins in Montana, the Bitterroot, the Big Hole, the Missions, and the Swan. So the initial formation of the Mission Range and the Swan Range, as you can see in the cross section down below, occurred around 50 or so million years ago. And that extension created blocks that went up and blocks that dropped down. Geologists refer to the up blocks as horst, H-O-R-S-T, horst. And the down blocks are referred to as graben, G-R-A-B-E-N, graben. And it's widely thought that this metamorphic core complex and extension that occurred in Western Montana was just a collapse of the piles and piles and piles of rocks that had been pushed together by the collision of the Pacific Ocean floor with North America. And as we added on pieces to North America and that collision zone stepped further and further west into Washington State, making Washington State, the fold and thrust belt Montana collapsed. It's like a bulldozer backing off a pile of dirt. But it's not dirt, it's rock. So it fractured into these normal faults or extensional faults, forming basins and ranges. And it's likely they're still active. There's very strong evidence that there was a 7.5 magnitude earthquake on the Mission Fault 7,700 years ago. And so that could happen tomorrow. The probability of it happening tomorrow is low, but it could happen tomorrow. So planners in the Flathead should be very concerned about earthquake-related hazards. I can envision a very large part of the Mission Flathead Range detaching in a landslide during an earthquake, hitting the lake and creating a tsunami wave that wipes Paulson off the map. You heard it here first. Okay, so as we go into the late Paleogene, 40 to 23 million years ago, we still are pulling the whole, you know, that we're pulling Montana apart. In fact, we're pulling the whole Western United States apart. And there's a zone of pull apart we call the zone of extension through Western Montana, shown in the map on the right. And in the zone of extension were basins that were dropping down, and they were preserving sediments from streams and lakes and swamps. And we have a wonderful fossil collection of mammals and insects and leaves and other plant fossils from this time period throughout Western Montana. There's a spectacular fossil insect locality in the Keshennan Formation, which is up your way, up by Glacier National Park in the North Fork, down, extending down in the Middle Fork of the Flathead. And we've got a spectacular locality in the Ruby down here, just off of the Ruby Reservoir. That fossil that you see of that flying insect in the middle, that I collected that from the site we call Fossil Basin over in the Ruby. Okay. By the Neogene, 23 to 5 million years ago, the Yellowstone hotspot becomes a factor in the geology of Montana. The hotspot broke out at where Nevada, Idaho, and Oregon meet. You can see that in the map on the lower left. That round area is the outbreak of the Yellowstone hotspot, and that occurred about 16 and a half million years ago. When it did, it domed up all of the rock around it, and it created the ancestral Missouri River, which you can see with the blue arrow flowing to the northeast. It actually flowed all the way up into Canada and deposited its sediment in Hudson Bay or some equivalent of it. And it caught the eruptive materials from Yellowstone as it progressed, as the plate moved over the hotspot to the southwest. The hotspot migrated to the northeast to its present locality in Yellowstone. And along the way, it sent evidence of its catastrophic, violent, eruptive history into Montana down the Missouri River drainage. The rock that you see on the right is a single ash deposit just east of Dillon, person for scale. That is world class. There are very few things like it on the planet. And it is not airfall. It got here by water. It is a lahar. It's a slurry of ash and water that came during a big caldera forming eruption about 10 million years ago when the caldera was underneath what is today Twin Falls, Idaho, or slightly to the northeast of there. The reason why there was so much water is because calderas are holes, so they hold water, just like Yellowstone Lake. If you breach the wall of the caldera, the lake spills out, and with it, all the ash during the eruption. And so these slurries of ash and water were bad days in Montana. And we find many of them. There are, you know, in the Dillon area, we can count easily 11 different events of eruptions and lahars that came down the ancestral Missouri River system, now exposed in the mountain ranges of southwest Montana, like the Blacktail Range and the Sweetwater Range. All right. Well, that all came to an end as Yellowstone migrated to its present position. As it got to its present position, the crust that had been doming up around it broke differently than it had been had broken initially. It broke instead of forming northeast trending valleys that the Missouri River followed, it broke new northwest trending valleys like the Red Rock Valley, like the Blacktail Valley, like the Sweetwater Valley, like the Alder Ruby River Valley. Okay? Those are all less than 4.5 million years old, those mountain ranges and those valleys. And we know this because of this site in the picture on the left. That's Timber Hill. It's on the Sweetwater Road between Dillon and Alder. And on the top of that hill is a basalt flow that came from Heise, Idaho on the Snake River Plain. And it flowed all the way into Montana. Now, lava flows don't go up and over mountains. So the mountains that we see today weren't there. It went down the ancestral Missouri River, like all the ash deposits before it. And it has since been offset by the Sweetwater Fault, shown by that dashed line. And you can see that it's dropped down, forming the hanging wall, it's listed, and it's gone up, forming the foot wall, as is written on the diagram. And that's basin range topography. So the downdrop block is the graben and the up block is the horst. And it cut right across the old ancestral Missouri River drainage. It's shown in the diagram on the right as the red line. The red line is the flow of lava, the Timber Hill basalt. And the black lines crossing it are the new northwest trending extensional faults, creating the new basin range and the modern topography we see today. As a result of the movement of the position of the hotspot as the plate went over it to a new place that caused a change in the stress field in the crust of the earth and broke new extensional faults. The active faults in southwest Montana are those northwest trending normal faults. And they are absolutely active. And we know that because one ruptured in 1959. We'll get to that in a minute. All right. The mountains that were created between 5 and say 2 million years ago, they were deeply eroded and buried. It's called pedimentation. And you can see in this picture, there's a flat surface below the mountains, right kind of, you know, 3/4 of the way up. And that's a pediment. That's the old valley floor surface about roughly, I would say, 3 million years ago. And everything since has been dissected through in the last couple of million years. So the old valley floor surface is that flat surface. And you've seen these all over Montana. It's very prominent in the Deer Lodge Valley, for example, the pediment there, showing the old valley floor. And now we have, you know, dissection and the formation of the new valley floor. All right, Yellowstone. The Yellowstone reaches the park at 2.1 million years ago, and it forms a big caldera. And that caldera produced a pyroclastic flow, a fire rock flow that deposited the unit that you can see with the quarter on the right. It's called the Huckleberry Ridge Tuff. And you can see it down the Madison Valley. It forms that segment that people call the Palisades in below Quake Lake that's very popular for fishing along the Madison. That cliff wall is held up by Huckleberry Ridge Tuff. That was a bad day. What happens is the caldera is like a big pop can and it's full of gas. And the gas starts to be released from the pop can because as it domes the rocks up, they crack. And the cracks that form release the gas. As the gas releases more and more, it starts to run away. And eventually then what happens is it goes into full-blown eruption of the magma chamber out these fracture systems in the overlying rock. And it will expel the material at supersonic speeds up to the stratosphere. And when the material reaches the stratosphere, it's too heavy to be held up and it descends down and squirts out and goes down all the river valleys around it at hundreds of miles per hour, carrying temperatures of hundreds of degrees Fahrenheit, thousands really. And it incinerates everything in its path and buries it in a thick pile of ash that turns to stone. And that's what you see in the picture on the right. That's at Mammoth just south of Gardner in the park. And that's the Huckleberry Ridge tuff up on Mount Everts, with its solidified tuff overlying some ash from the initial eruption, and then orange under that, which is baking that occurred when the hot material landed on the ground, finally touched the ground, okay? Once you've expelled all that material, then the caldera forms, the ground collapses into that space. And it makes the big gigantic caldera hole that we now know as Yellowstone. All right. And of course it's erupted three times in the last 2 million years, 2.1, 1.3, and 639,000 years ago. Will it erupt tomorrow? No. Will erupt in your lifetime? It's a very low probability. I'd be much more worried that you're going to be killed in a back alleyway than you are going to be killed by an eruption of Yellowstone. Okay, so then the ice shows up in the last 2 million years. I'm almost done. And a big ice sheet comes down out of Canada. That's called the Laurentide Ice Sheet. You can see it in the diagram on the left. And big blocks of ice come down into the Flathead area. That's called the Cordilleran Ice Sheet and the Rocky Mountain Ice Sheets. Yellowstone was covered by an ice cap, and many of the mountain ranges had ice caps on them as well, as you can see in the map. Close up of the Mission and Swan area, a lobe of ice coming down out of Canada and off of the high regions of Glacier and so on, extended down those valleys. They went down as far south as Paulson during the last advance and formed what's called the Paulson Moraine, which is what is the raised land below the lake. Another glacier split off of that and went around the Mission Valley, and that one went down the Swan. And that we call the Swan Valley Glacier. So the Flathead Lobe down the Flathead Valley and the Swan Valley Glacier down that valley. All right, and you can see the evidence of the glaciation all over the place in both valleys. All right, and of course we had glacial lakes. The ice coming down out of Canada blocked the Clark Fork and created a gigantic lake in Western Montana, Glacial Lake Missoula, which then would float the ice and catastrophically spill out across Eastern Washington, creating the scablands of Eastern Washington. And we see evidence of those outburst floods in the ripples in Camas Prairie, for example, which is the photograph on the right. Those ripples formed during one of the floods of Glacial Lake Missoula as water moving very rapidly caused sediment to roll and hop and form into ripples. But as celebrated as Glacial Lake Missoula is, lots of people don't realize that we had glacial lakes all along the High Line throughout central and eastern Montana. Glacial Lake Great Falls, blocked by the Laurentide Ice Sheet, Glacial Lake Mussel Shell, Glacial Lake Jordan, Glacial Lake Glendive, Glacial Lake Circle, and on. And they also had their catastrophic floods. Glacial Lake Great Falls, for example, catastrophically flooded through the Shonkin Sag in central Montana, scouring out the igneous rocks there and leaving behind some lakes like Hidden Lake and dry falls as well. All right, in the last 10,000 or so years, 11,700 to present, what's called the Holocene, the ground of the earth in southwest Montana is still going up and down, and the rivers have been cutting down through, through much of the Pleistocene as well as the Holocene, and they create terraces that show us where the river used to be. So these are the terraces of the Madison Valley, and they show us the position where the Madison River used to be as it's been dissecting down through the valley over time. people showed up about 14,000 years ago, we think, in Montana, the Dillon area. There's a site south of here that was a tool making site. There's clear evidence of human interaction with mammoth in southwest Montana. So mammoths were still around at the time that people were here. And we, of course, find pictographs and petroglyphs. And this picture on the right is of the Block Mountain area. And there's a syncline. You can see the word buffalo jump. And there's a syncline there, which is a downfold in the rock. And Native people would use that natural downfold in the rock to run bison down the valley to where it narrows and off the cliff edge, where they then would break their legs and they could finish them off and process the meat in their encampments that were located there along the Big Hole River. So there you go, geology and Native Americans, Native people interacting, really cool. Immigrant Montanans show up in the 1860s in force, and it's related back to the mineral deposits that formed by those intrusions of igneous rock during Cretaceous time. So that past geological event created most of the deposits, not all of them, but many of them. And they were exploited by people. The photograph on the left is Alder Gulch, where there's a hydraulic dredge that is working the tailings. And on the right is the adit at Elkhorn in the Pioneer Scenic Byway, bleeding out some metallic minerals that are orange, iron orange in the water. All right. And then earthquakes. So we're still actively pulling apart in Montana. The ground's still going up and it's still dropping down. And that happened in a big way in 1959 with the largest earthquake ever recorded in the Rocky Mountain region, a 7.5 magnitude on the Richter scale. And it you can see in the photograph on the left, that's the surficial offset from the earthquake. So that's ground rupture. There's a human being in there for scale, if you can see it. The maximum ground rupture there was about 27 feet. That's a lot. And you can still see that scarp today. There's a nice pullout at Cabin Creek in the whole Quake Lake visitor region that's worth your time. Of course, it generated the landslide that dammed the Madison River and made Quake Lake. But they're not done, as you all know in Montana. The chimney on the right is my neighbor's. That's what happened to it after the 2005 earthquake here in Dillon. That earthquake raised the Pioneer Mountains just a little bit and dropped the Beaverhead Valley just a little bit. And it shook us up pretty bad down here in the Dillon area. I have a turn of the century Victorian house and it's perched on rocks that are not held together with anything. So my fingers are crossed that we don't have a quake-like event. In at least the time of my ownership. And with that, I am done and open for questions.
Rob, my mind is just blown. And I want to tell everybody here, just if you were like me and we're scurrying, taking notes, just remember this is being recorded and we'll have it posted in a couple of days. And you know, came from Southwest Montana, so amazing all of that geology. There's just all of it so amazing, and yes. The earthquakes. And thinking about how, you know, geology is actively happening, even though it seems like so long ago. Also hilarious that you just refer to like 50 million years, like it was last week. No big deal. It makes me want to go, it makes me want to take a class with you, take a sabbatical and take a geology class. Holy buckets, what a gift this presentation has been. We do have some questions. Thank you. We do have some questions coming in. So want to get to all of that. And the first one is, could you explain, a lot of your slides after words had had letters, G-A-M-A-K-A, various different letters. Can you explain what that is?
Yeah. Okay. So I don't see one right off the bat, but we'll keep looking at the gravelly range because it's pretty. The MA stands for mega annum, which is millions of years ago. And GA stands for giga annum, which means billions of years ago. It's just shorthand.
Neat. You know, every industry has their own little shorthand abbreviations. I've never even heard those words.
Yeah. Mega annum and giga annum.
Love it. I love those science sexy terms is what I call that. Science. had a great comment that I fully agree with that says my brain hurts in a good way. what are your geological predictions for the future? Outside of, you know, the tidal wave that's going to take out Polson.
Okay, so
I never thought about that.
I don't want to offend anyone in Butte because you and I both know the danger in that. And I love Butte people and I love Butte. But Our Lady is rising into the heavens and Butte is dropping into the pits of hell along the Continental Fault. And the Continental Fault is a very active fault. And if it were to rupture with a 7.5 magnitude earthquake, it would likely break the Yankee Doodle Tailings Pond Dam and send a slurry of wet contaminated sediment that would hit the pit and cause a tsunami wave of contaminated water that would wipe across Uptown Butte. It would be catastrophic.
Wow.
The flats are not a respite from this problem because the flats used to be a swamp, a lake, Washoe Lake, and they drained it when they drained the mines. And so what do humans do when they see lakes go away? Ooh, real estate. So they built the country club and Evel Knievel shows up and the Walmart comes in and the Toyota dealer. And now if it were to hit, if you'd have a big earthquake, the water's rising back up because they're not pumping the mines. So that's now all water saturated lake sediment. That shakes like a bowl of Jell-O during an earthquake. So the worst shaking would be down in the flats. And it'll cause big areas of the flats to collapse, a process called liquefaction. It happened in Anchorage, Alaska in 1964. And literally, Walmart could fall into a gigantic hole that opened up in the earth during the shaking.
I'm not going to share any opinions about that right now.
Earthquakes are the thing that people should worry the most about. And the other is landslides. And the other are flash floods. We're a desert. And the ground that we look around and see in Southwest Montana in particular, and it looks dry to us, those are just rivers that aren't active right now. But one bad thunderstorm over the Blacktail Deer Range and you have a flood on the alluvial fans coming down into Dillon. Those are now covered by houses. And people don't know. They think that's dry land. It's not. It's a river, but it only has water in it on a decadal basis.
Fascinating.
So Yellowstone volcano is not the thing to get fuzzed up about. It's about earthquakes, landslides, and flash floods.
The the woman that asked that question commented she was a little sorry she asked, but that's transformation. Well, that said, here's another question.
There's still very low probabilities, right?
In our lifetime, right?
Oh, yeah. And
so I guess to follow up with that, so I know like in Yellowstone, of course, there are, there's all sorts of sensors, like they're yes. constantly sort of monitoring.
Oh yeah, is the most wired place on Earth, yes.
Is that monitoring happening in Butte or elsewhere around the state or the United yeah. States?
We have a fabulous Bureau of Mines and Geology in Montana. They're at the Montana Tech campus in Butte, and our state seismologist, just in case it gets back to him, Mike Stickney, is the best. We have the best state seismologist in the United States, and I'll stand by that. And so Mike, in a very small operation up in Butte, monitors earthquake activity, as does, of course, the U.S. Geological Survey. The earthquake hazard potential is carefully monitored, but it's very, very, it's impossible to predict, you know, that we're going to have a large magnitude earthquake in any time that would be, you know, in advance enough to be of any value.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the dogs barking and the birds going silent in the trees, you know, is too late.
Mm-hmm. Right. And I was in that 2005 earthquake and never had experienced anything quite like it. And it is a phenomenon that is almost hard to articulate.
It was. I would go to the coffee shop and people would come up to me like I'd caused it. You know, when is it going to stop? Because we were having aftershocks and it caused a lot of anxiety. The psychologists in Dillon were very busy.
Yeah, it was interesting. Oh gosh, that's a whole nother show. We'll have to have you back. Okay, so all that said, what is the coolest geological feature that you've ever seen?
Oh boy. That is an almost impossible question to answer. I have to say that from my research work, I think that these gigantic ash deposits in Southwest Montana are some of the most spectacular things I've ever seen. They're incredible. I can envision myself standing in the ancestral Missouri River fishing in a wall of water and ash, you know, is coming my way and a compression wave hits me before a drop of water touches me and probably causes my body to rip into a zillion tiny pieces. And then it all gets buried in this slurry of water and ash. That deposit is impressive. And it's impressively exposed to where you can get in it. It forms into hoodoos, into towers. And you can wander around in the towers and be in the deposit. That is spectacular.
This has been a surprisingly violent presentation, Rob. There's a lot of earth violence I didn't even know.
Earth is a not safe place.
No, that is really, and I appreciate that. And that you had shown the picture of that's really great. Here's another couple of questions coming at you.
Okay, I see you.
Could you remember, or could you remind everyone the photo of the pediment formation that you presented? Yeah. Where was that?
Oh, yeah. Isn't that a great place? Okay. Do you know where it is?
That's in the Upper Ruby.
Yeah, very good. Snowcrest Range is what we're looking at. I'm standing on top of Timber Hill, which is a peak that I summit every year. And I'm looking to the northeast, and mostly what we're seeing, that's all Snowcrest Range. The Greenhorn Range is out of view on the left. And so that's the Upper Ruby. It's really Sweetwater Creek is what it is. So you can get there by following the Sweetwater Road from Dillon past the talc plant or the talc mine, the Regal Talc Mine, on the Sweetwater Road. And you take the dog leg turn where it crosses the Timber Hill Basalt Flow. That's the canyon cut of the Sweetwater Creek. And then it turns abruptly to the north and goes into Ruby Reservoir. And you can't miss Timber Hill. You can see it in the distance, and there's public access. It's cross country, but it's public access.
Thank you. Thank you for that.
Yes. It's a special place. People should be careful up there. Peregrine falcons nest up there, and there's a black bear that hangs out up there, and there are now increasingly grizzly bears in the area. So people, A, should be cautious, and B, very sensitive to that place. It's a very special place.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. Yeah, thanks for saying that. Can you elaborate on the Island Park caldera?
Yeah, it erupted 1.3 million years ago, and it created a wonderful caldera, smaller than the others. It is thought to be a resurgent dome. So Yellowstone today, the Yellowstone caldera that forms the caldera that you see from Dunraven Pass in Yellowstone Park and looking out across the landscape towards the canyon, the Grand Canyon of the Yellowstone, that's in the Yellowstone caldera. Within the Yellowstone caldera and the Huckleberry Ridge caldera, which overlap one another, there was a raised area of magma that we referred to as a resurgent dome. Today, the resurgent domes occur in the Yellowstone caldera. One's called the Mallard Lake Dome, and the other's called the, one's up by the Hayden Valley, and the other's down by Old Faithful. The Mallard Lake Dome is down by Old Faithful. Sour Creek Dome, there it is. It's a hair memory thing. And so the Sour Creek and Mallard Lake Dome. So if people can see my hand, that's the Yellowstone caldera magma. So there's this big long conduit, my arm, that goes down deep into the earth, maybe as far as the core mantle boundary. Then there's a magma chamber here at my knuckles. And that magma chamber has two pipes feeding off of it. One is underneath Sour Lake, and the other is the Mallard Lake and Sour Creek domes. It's thought that the Island Park caldera was a dome like these two domes, and that it erupted and collapsed, forming that smaller caldera that we call the Island Park caldera. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
Awesome. And it's starting to fill up with basalt, which is the last phase of caldera formation. They start filling in with ocean floor-like rock, basalt. And that's when they're headed to being done and buried, like the Snake River Plain. And the Island Park caldera is a spectacular teaching tool because it's in the middle. It's between the caldera phase and the filling in with basalt phase. So you can see it in that transition, which is really super cool.
Yeah, neat. Moving back up to this neck of the woods, several questions, wondering if you have any predictions for the Swan Valley, any drama to anticipate in the Swan Valley geologically? Well,
Yeah, well, the Swan Valley Fault is just like the Mission Fault. In fact, they probably merge with one another at depth. They have a curvature to them, and they probably curve down and merge with one another into a flat fault at depth, or a lower angle fault at depth. And so movement along the Mission Fault rather could cause movement along the Swan, and movement along the Swan could occur on its own, and cause movement on the Mission Fault, or maybe not. And the thing to recognize is that we know that it can produce at least a 7.5 magnitude earthquake, because those same fault types did so at Quake Lake in 1959. So there can be no question it can produce a 7.5 magnitude quake. Now, will that happen in anybody's lifetime that's listening to this? Probably not. Life is about probabilities. And the probability of that rupturing is relatively low. Could it happen tomorrow and everybody say that damn professor said that it wasn't going to happen in my lifetime? Yeah, it could happen tomorrow.
It's neat. We've got lots of questions around the state. We'll see how much time we have to get to all of the other places and your predictions, but kind of the same idea. Here's a question again in the Swan. What Paleogean fossils or any other fossils for that matter are prevalent or that you found in the Swan?
Almost none. So here's the picture. The cross section, and you can see the Mission and Swan faults, and you can see that the rock that forms the Mission range and forms the Swan range are under Middle Proterozoic Missoula group belt rocks. Those were deposited before multicellular animals existed on the planet. So you're not going to find any clams, you're not going to find any brachiopods, you're not going to find any trilobites. But you will find algal structures or cyanobacterial structures called stromatolites. So look for that thing down in the lower right, the crinkly domal layers. That's called a stromatolite. And it's built by mats of cyanobacteria, which are just photosynthetic bacteria, and they trap sediment and they create these domes. They still are around today. They occur in Shark's Bay in Australia. They tend to occur where there are no animals to eat them in the modern world. So Shark's Bay is a really nasty place in terms of salinity, no snails around, cyanobacteria flourish. The belt was deposited at a time when there weren't any snails around. So they didn't eat them. And so stromatolites are abundant in the belt. So look for those. Those are the fossils in the rocks in the Swan Range.
Neat. Let's see here. And so what about, is there any sort of, like you had talked about finding a sample, is there any legality surrounding, like if you were to find a fossil or find a rock?
Thanks. Yes. Okay. So vertebrate fossils of any kind are illegal to collect on any public land without a permit. BLM, Forest Service, national parks, of course, state parks, of course, cannot collect vertebrate fossils without a permit. And you can't just get a permit. The people that are permitted are people that have credentials. If you found a dinosaur bone on public land, you should leave it. That's the law. The invertebrate fossils can be collected from public land. So if you find clams, or nautiloid shells, ammonites, you can collect those. Those are fair game. Fort Peck Reservoir, for example. Oh, great place to collect fossil clams and fossil ammonites, fossil squids. Great place. They occur in the Bear Paw Shale along the banks of the Fort Peck Reservoir. In the Dillon area, there's a place I always send people with kids down at Clark Canyon Reservoir because they can collect these guys on the right. They just weather right out of the rock like you see in this picture. I didn't clean those fossils. They came right out of the rock like that. And the kids can just pick them up off the ground. There's a site people can join called Montana Geology Facebook. It's a Facebook site called Montana Geology. I run it. And there's a map that shows how to get to this fossil collecting locality on Clark Canyon Reservoir.
That's so generous of you.
There's a zillion fossils. They could never, the kids could never, it's a great place to send. I mean, we need to interest people in the natural world. I think that's fairly clear these days. And so I really want people to go down there. They could never collect it all. It renews itself every year with weathering. And there's billions of fossils in this place. And so collect away and bring the kids so that we can get them interested early on.
Love it. That is so kind. Let's see here. So many questions. So along the Flathead River near PERMA, there are sections of basaltic rock and sedimentary rock. Can you explain this?
Which fork of the Flathead? Where was it?
Near PERMA.
PERMA. Okay. I've been everywhere, and I don't believe I've been to PERMA. but it can only be one thing. It is very likely the Kashenan Formation, which is valley fill sediment, as the valley that the Flathead River occupies dropped down, and it accumulated sediment, and it buried the fossils of mammals and insects and leaves. Are a common fossil type. Fossil wood is common in the Kashenan Formation. It's really the only fossil bearing unit up near Glacier National Park. Everything else is belt rock up there. And the only thing you're gonna find in that are stromatolites.
Great, thank you.
Yep.
Another question was, can you expound a little bit about the hot springs Montana area?
Oh yeah. Okay. Again, the bedrock is primarily belt rock in hot springs. The whole western part of the state is primarily, northwestern part of the state is primarily belt rocks. There's a few slivers of Cambrian rocks with some trilobite fossils in them. Hither, thither, and yon, really isolated. There's some up by Libby, for example, that have whole trilobites in them about, you know, the size of a quarter. But most of the rocks are belt rocks. Superimposed upon them occurs are glacial deposits and features because ice covered that area and glacial water. From Glacier Lake Missoula covered that area. And so you can find glacial till, the sediment that's deposited by ice, and you can find features that are, you know, erosional features from the scour of the glacier, scouring the rock and polishing it. There are grooves in the belt rocks, we call striations, where the ice moving over the rock, carrying rock in it, is like sandpaper, grinding over the belt rocks and leaving polished and scraped rock behind. with lines in it called striations. Look for that.
Awesome. Could you please show the ash picture again while I'm getting to your next questions? Some great comments here that you'll have to go back and read when I send this to you. So great. And that's what you're saying, that the ash picture, one of your favorite.
Everything you're looking at in that picture, except for my daughter, was deposited 10 million years ago in a single day.
That's amazing.
And that's not the whole deposit. It goes down below me at least another 20 feet.
That is
it's truly awesome.
Truly.
It's totally awesome. Look at the big chunks of white in it. See that? Those are pieces of ash that have been deposited upstream and got ripped up and transported in this slurry of ash.
Crazy.
This thing contains some of the wildest sedimentary structures I've ever seen in my life. It was a very, very viscous flow. Lahars are viscous flows. It's like flowing cold, syrup out of the refrigerator, but it's moving rapidly. Wow. It's moving at maybe 100 miles an hour or more. But it's thick. So you have this thick, viscous thing that's moving very rapidly, and it creates just bizarre structures, swirls, and all kinds of crazy things.
That is crazy.
And you can get right inside of the flow because you can walk up these channels in the ash, And I ask people, do not mar them. People have carved their names. You can see it in the lower right. It's just, people have done this. It's tradition. They can't help themselves. But please don't do it. It frankly goes away pretty quickly. This ash is eroding very rapidly. And I always love Sally and Jim, forever mark their love in the rock, and 5 years later it's gone. As maybe was the love.
I was just gonna say, right. Let's see. So here's another question.
Oh, and this place is spectacular for birds. And so don't go in the early spring, because the owls are nesting, the peregrine falcons are nesting here, the bluebirds are nesting here, the swallows are nesting here. It is a menagerie of birds here. And it's best to go in July, August, when they're out of there.
That's so kind to think about that holistic perspective. Thank you. Mm-hmm. We'll just do one or two more questions here. You had like 40 questions. How far down the Swan Glacier go? I understood it stopped around Summit Lake. And about how wide was this glacier? How much of the Swan Range was covered?
Swan Range itself was glaciated and it merged with the Valley Glacier. So one of the things I should point out in that is there are two glaciers. There's a tongue of glacier that came down as this massive ice coming out of Canada and the domes of ice over the park and so on. And those are coming down the Swan Valley. And at the same time, you've got glaciers coming out of the high country in the Swan Range and merging with that Valley Glacier. So the Alpine glaciers are merging with the Valley Glacier and the Swan, especially towards the toe of the glacier. Now, there were two advances of the glacier, and one of them went actually all the way down around Obando.
Wow.
And there's some pothole lakes down there where the till was deposited, and there were icebergs in the till that were left behind and made pothole lakes, kettle lakes. And then there was the younger advance, which was not as far down and stopped about where the person said.
Mm-hmm. It's Summit Lake.
Yeah.
Well, we, you know, being the wettest watershed in the state with more than 4,000 wetlands, we certainly attribute that to the glacier. And is that true? That was one of the questions was when you reference evidences of glaciers in the Swan that we see today, could you talk about that?
Yeah. So the many of those high alpine lakes were carved in out of, those were cirques carved out by the glacial ice and the alpine glacial ice coming out of the Swan Range. So the glaciers descending out of the range, they descend off the high peaks, and when they flatten out, they make a scoop out of the rock like an ice cream scooper, taking a gouge of rock out. And that creates a hole called a cirque. And if that cirque is not permeable, so permeable that water can go through it, it will hold water in it, and that's called a tarn. So the high lakes in the range, and the same in the Mission, are glacial tarns, gouged out by the ice and sitting in cirque bowls. Now, some of the lakes down at valley level formed because glaciers dammed, they dumped sediment and dammed water, and those are called marinally dammed lakes. So those are the places where the glaciers stopped and water impounded behind them as the glacier retreated. Now, the water that you see today in that lake, of course, is not the glacial water. That's the migration of water through the system over the Holocene to the present with snowmelt and groundwater flow through that system over time. But the basin that holds the water that makes the lake, that all formed during the glacial advance. And then the glacier that went down the Swan Valley itself, as it was going down the valley, it hopped and hopped and hopped and hopped over topography. And every time it went over a bump in the topography, it took a gouge out of the rock and it made a hole. And that hole is fills with water and makes a lake. And some are trapped behind retreating deposits of the ice called moraine. So some are just gouged out in the valley and some are trapped behind moraines. And some are both. Some are gouged out and behind moraines. Does that make sense?
Yes. Yes, that is a lot.
So yes, the topography that holds water was generated by the glaciation. That's the easiest way to think about it.
Right. That's a lot of, that's good. I just want to mention, you have lots of explanations. Perma is where Hot Spring, the road from Hot Springs meets 200. So it's over in that direction.
Okay. Probably still Belt Rock. And then the light colored rock over there is similar to the Kishinen formation. It's called the Renova formation.
Oh, right. I've heard that. Got lots of great comments about, and from several geologists about how you have condensed all of this information into a really enjoyable hour. So I think the last thing was just, could you go to your last slide and just talk a little bit about that? And then we will let you go. We've kept you way long tonight. Thank you.
That's okay. That is, of course, Black Butte in the Gravelly Range. And for those Montanans that have not yet been there, that is a life lister and you have to go. The flowers are spectacular. I think I'm up there in this shot probably in August. And so even in August, it's still really green and lots of flowers. I'm not, you know, a flower expert by any stretch, but one of the things that I took a picture of once up there and posted on a flower site, and somebody told me it was really super rare, were pink lupin. So
oh, wow.
there's pink lupin up there. And they're pink. I mean, they look like they were made by Mattel, you know, and packaged by Barbie. They're that pink. And so there's the plants. The mountain off in the distance is Black Butte. It's over 10,000 feet, and it's like Devil's Tower. It's the interior of an old volcano. It's the neck or the inside of a volcano. And it is, it's Miocene in age, roughly, I don't know, blanking on the number, but about 20 some odd million years old, 20 to 30 million years old. And so the volcano's gone, and you're just seeing the hard rock that fed the volcano in the interior of it. But it's sitting now on the surface, you know, of this mountain range, 10,000 feet. All around it are Mesozoic and Paleozoic sedimentary rocks. And the rocks actually in the foreground here that you're looking at that are red and beige in color, tan in color. Jack Horner told me that he collected a bunch of dinosaur fossils out of those rocks. They're Cretaceous seaway deposits. So they were deposited in that western interior seaway that I showed in the one map. But here they are sitting at 10,000 feet, you know, in the gravelly range now today. Why? Because the gravelly range is a big uplifted block, a horst, a big extensional block that's being raised as the crust is being pulled apart. In the foreground is a stone sitting out there all by its lonesome. And it is not from around there. So how did it get there? Well, the ice brought it and dumped it. So glaciers covered all of this during the last glacial advance. And that those glaciers plucked that rock from probably over in the Ruby Range or Snowcrest Range, sorry, in the Snowcrest Range and dumped it in the Gravelly Range. It possibly excavated it out of the Gravelly Range as and deposited it in the Gravelly Range, but it was definitely transported by the ice.
This has been such a fascinating night of storytelling by with you translating the language of the earth, Rob. And again, I can't thank you enough. Is there a way that folks can reach you perhaps at the university and share that information?
Yeah, my email is just, it's rob.thomas@umwestern, all one word, U as in underground, M as in mother, Western. So rob.thomas@umwestern, and it's .edu.
Great. I really appreciate that. And I will get this recording to you so that you can see all the wonderful comments. Sure. Friends far and wide. I had an international audience tonight, so that was really exciting. Cool. And
they can check out the Montana Facebook geology site as well. It's Montana Geology. It's a group, Montana Geology on Facebook. So there's a number of us that post, lessons, if you will, about Montana geology.
Wonderful. The one reason perhaps to get on Facebook.
And, good point.
and again, everyone, please go to your local bookstore or you can come to the Swan Valley Connections office to get the updated versions of the Roadside Geology of Montana book. And we hope that you will all join us on March 1st for a program on the owls of Montana. And if anyone would like to support these programs, you're also welcome to donate at www.swanvalleyconnections.org. Rob, again, thank you so much. It's been such a pleasure. I look forward to catching up with you again when I'm down in your neck of the woods soon. And of course, anytime you want to come up to the Swan, we'd love to host you as well. So thank you again, everyone. Have a wonderful winter night and Groundhog's Day, 6 more weeks. So buckle in. And but the spring is stirring beneath our feet as we speak. So we look forward to seeing everybody again throughout the year. Rob, thanks again so much.
You're welcome.
We'll talk to you soon. Bye-bye.
Thank you.